Evgueni Abakoumov from Gustave Eiffel University, who will talk on, about Cauchy Branges spaces of entire functions. Eugene, please.
Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for giving the possibility to speak here. So I will talk about our joint works with Anton Baranov and Yuri Belov from St. Petersburg. And it will concern Cauchy branch spaces of entire functions. Okay. So we will introduce a class of spaces of entire functions, which is a more general class than the branch spaces, which we discussed in yesterday's Alex talk. And we will concern mostly two problems, two class of problems. First of all, the structure of invariants of spaces and the localization of zero phenomena for functions from these spaces. Okay. So let me start with reminding you the classical. Do you see my screen?
Yes, perfectly. I cannot see you, but the screen is visible.
But how, yes, okay, thank you. So let me start with Burling theorem, classical result by Burling 1949, which gives a description of shift invariant spaces in the Hardy space H2. Okay, so a non-zero Z invariant subspace of H2 are of the form theta H2, where theta is an NN function. And so the backward shift invariants of spaces are of the form, they are orthogonal complements of theta H2, and they are so-called model subspaces. So we have a complete understanding of the lattice of invariant subspaces. It's quite rich. And let's now go to nearly invariant subspaces. A closed subspace of H2 is said to be nearly invariant if f of z over z belongs to this subspace whenever f is in E and f vanishes in zero. It's easy to see that backward shift invariant subspaces are all nearly invariant, but there are a lot of other nearly invariant subspaces. And these subspaces were characterized in works by Sarason and Heat in 1987 and 1988. And they were useful to describe the invariant subspaces of the Hardy space on an annulus and other domains and on C. Okay. The operator of multiplication by Z is bounded on many spaces of analytic functions on the union disk, but usually it's not bounded on spaces of entire functions. On the contrary, nearly invariant subspace is a natural class of invariant subspace, which can be considered in spaces of analytic functions in on the whole plane. And it turns out that in some natural spaces of entire functions, all nearly invariant subspaces are ordered by inclusion. So the situation is completely different from what we have seen for the Hardy space and other spaces of functions on the unit disk. Now we will introduce these spaces, which we call Cauchy Branges spaces. I will try to explain why we call the space Cauchy Branges spaces. Okay, so let's fix some free parameter. First of all, T will be a sequence of complex numbers which tends to infinity. And we put some measure on the set T. So it's infinite sum of Dirac measures, the sum of mu n delta tn, where delta tn is Dirac measure at the point tn, we'll consider positive measures such that the series mu n divided by the square of the modulus tn plus 1 is convergent. So we fix these two objects. So the set C, it's a sequence which goes to infinity and some measure, positive measure on the set C. Now we consider some entire function which has zeros exactly at the points of T. And it has simple zeros. We may associate to any such T and mu a space which we'll call H T A mu of entire functions, which is defined in the following way. So first of all, we consider the Cauchy transform on this measure mu, which is represented by this series. And this is, of course, a meromorphic function, so which has poles exactly on the points Tn. To get rid of this pole, so we can multiply this Cauchy transform, this meromorphic function, by the function a of z. Okay. So in the points tn, we have a simple poles, and then we multiply by an entire function which has simple zero. So we obtain an entire function. We obtain an entire function f, and we consider the set of all entire functions of this sort, where a n is a sequence from the sequence space L2. Okay. It will be our class of entire functions, and we will keep this function with the norm, just usual L2 norm of the sequence A. Okay. So now the norm of F is just the L2 norm of the sequence A. On the first glance, it looks like a strange object. It's not very easy to define, but it turns out that it's a very natural class of functions. I'd like to make a remark that actually the main parameters here are t and mu, and we have a free some choice. We can choose the function a in many different ways, but it's not important in the sense that, roughly speaking, for any a satisfying this property, we obtain the same space of entire functions. So sometimes I will omit a and just write h t mu. Okay, so this study of these spaces was initiated about 20 years ago, I think, in two papers by Yuri Belov, Mengesti, and Christian Seip. And we will continue the study of these spaces. Okay. These spaces. Each of these spaces has a so-called division property. More precisely, so if f is a function of this space, which vanishes at the point w, then we can divide f by z minus w, and we are in this space. And each space is also reproducing kernel Hilbert space. It turns out that these two properties characterize this class of spaces. In other words, if we have some reproducing kernel Hilbert space of entire functions, which has a division property, and it has a least basis of reproducing kernels in H, then H is a Cauchy de Branges space for some data T and mu. Okay, so Cauchy de Branges spaces are exactly the spaces, so reproducing kernel Hilbert spaces of entire functions, which has division property and which has a least basis of reproducing kernels in H. it can be easily checked that the functions which are written here, so the functions a of z divided by z minus tn, normalized by some, multiplied by some constant, form an orthogonal basis in the space, Cauchy de Branges space H, T, and B, and other reproducing kernels and the points Tn. Okay, let me now compare this class of spaces with the class of de Branges spaces. Okay, so I recall one of the definitions of de Branges spaces now. So Alex, in his yesterday's talk, presented two equivalent definitions using Hermite-Baylor functions and abstract definition of the Branges spaces. And I will now discuss the third equivalent definition of the Branges spaces. But first of all, let me recall the abstract definition of the Branges spaces. The Branges spaces is a Hilbert space of entire functions, which have the following, satisfy the following three axioms. The elements of H are entire functions, and the point evaluation are continuous linear functional on H. In other words, H is a reproducing, reproducing kernel Hilbert space. The second is that if a function F is an H, then the function which is defined as the complex conjugate of F of Z bar also belongs to the space H and has the same norm. And the third property is that if W is a complex number which is not real, and the function F in H vanishes in, at the point W, then we can somehow switch the zero W to the complex conjugate of W. In other words, so we divide F by Z minus W, we multiply it by Z minus W bar, and it turns out that we obtain the function from the same space and with the same norm. Okay, so the Branges space is a space which satisfies these three axioms. And the classical example of the Branges space is Pelle-Wiener space, which is the space of Fourier transforms of the functions from L2 on the interval minus AA. And now I will discuss the third equivalent definition of the Branges spaces. It turns out that the Branges spaces are exactly the spaces H, T, A, mu, which we defined at the beginning of this talk, such that mu is supported by the real line. In other words, the set T is a sequence of real lines, which tends to infinity. Donc, any space H, T, A, mu is with mu supported by the real line is a de Branges space, and vice versa, any de Branges space can be represented in this way. So the measure mu is called a spectral measure for this space. Sometimes one use other terms like Clark measure and so on. And in our example, classical example of Pelle-Wiener space, the functions of whose Fourier transforms, the Fourier transform of the functions of L2 on the interval minus pi pi are, is the space H T A mu where T is equal to Z, so the set of integers, and mu n is equal to one for any n. Now, as also Alex discussed in his talk, the theory of the Branges spaces is quite developed. There is a very nice connections with canonical system of differential equations. I will not discuss these relations here, but one of the most intriguing results in the Branges theory is the following ordering subspace theorem. Roughly speaking, it says that the family of all the Branges subspaces, it means isometrically embedded subspaces to our the Branges space, is ordered by inclusion. So we have chains of invariant subspaces. However, given that the Branges space, it's a very difficult problem to reconstruct the chain of the Branges space subspaces starting from the Branges space. Now we will discuss the following question. Is it possible to generalize, to extend the Branges result to some class at least of Cauchy de Branges spaces? Okay, so we assume that T is a sequence of complex numbers, and our result is that under some condition on our data, we have similar results. So all subspaces are ordered by inclusion. So let me first discuss these three property, these three cases when we can extend the Branges result. First of all, we will assume that T has a finite convergence exponent, which we will denote by CE of T, and it is defined as the infimum of positive k such that the series converges, the series of the modulus of Tn to the power minus k. So the three cases are the following. The first case, which we will note by Z, is that T is the zero set of some entire function of zero exponential type. So there is no geometrical condition on T. T can be arbitrary sequence in the complex plane which goes to infinity, but it should be a zero set of some entire function of zero exponential type. The second case is the following. T lies in some strip on the complex plane and has finite convergence exponent. T lies in some strip and has finite convergence exponent. And the third property, there is also some geometric condition on T. T lies in some angle of size P gamma. So it's angle of size less than pi. And the convergence exponent of T is strictly less than gamma to the power minus one. So you see that when gamma approaches one, the angle approaches the angle of size pi, gamma to the power minus one approaches one. Okay, so we have these three cases, Z, P, and A gamma, and we will now discuss invariant subspaces. So let's go back to nearly invariant subspaces. So we have seen the definition. I recall it here. A closed subspace A0 of a Cauchy de Branges space H is said to be nearly invariant if the function f divided by z minus w0 belongs to its space whenever f is in the space and f vanishes at the point w0. There is a priori a stronger property of division invariance, namely that if w is a complex number such that there exists f with f of w non-zero, then f of z over z minus w belongs to h0 whenever f vanishes at zero. But it turns out that in in this context, these properties are equivalent. So division invariance is equivalent to nearly invariance. So we will deal with nearly invariance of spaces in Cauchy de Branche space. And there is a class of natural examples of nearly invariance of space. Given a function g from our Cauchy de Branche space, so we can consider the subspace of its space defined as the closed linear span of the functions g divided by z minus lambda, where g of lambda is zero. And the same construction works in the case when g is probably not in the space, but g divided by z minus lambda is in the space. For example, for Pelle-Wiener space, the function g is just the function sine, which is not in the space, but sine divided by z minus lambda is in the Pelle-Wiener space. And it's easy to see that if g has only simple zeros, then hg is nearly invariant also, and division invariant. The subspaces constructed here are also Cauchy de Branche spaces, subspaces. They satisfy the axioms, two axioms of Cauchy de Branche subspaces. It's very easy to see, and we don't know for the moment if there are other division invariant subspaces which are not of this particular form AG. Okay, so we are interested in nearly invariant subspaces for Cauchy de Branche spaces in these three cases, and we have the following result. So if T satisfy one of the conditions Z or A gamma, so the first and third conditions which I discussed before, then we have ordered structure. In other words, if we have two nearly invariant subspaces without common zeros, then either H1 is an H2 or H2 is an H1. In the case, second case, when T is lies in a strip, say in the strip imaginary part of Z is between minus H and H, then we should add some extra condition. We suppose that H1 and H2 are closed under this star transform, which we discussed in the definition of the Branche spaces. And if it's the case, then also either H1 is a subset of H2 or H2 is a subset of H1. So we have ordered structure for division invariant subspaces under one of these three conditions, Z, A gamma, and P. In this condition, we denote that. Nevertheless, in some situation, it is not very general fact that invariant subspaces are ordered by inclusion. We have this theorem example of Cauchy de Branche space or of order two. It means that all functions are of order not greater than two. And it's possible to construct two nearly invariant subspaces which are stable by this star operation without common zero, such that neither H1 is in H2 nor H2 is in H1. So it's an interesting question to find a reasonably rich class of Cauchy de Branche spaces which satisfy the ordering structure for division invariant subspaces. Now let me discuss briefly some applications. So we started to study Cauchy de Branche spaces. Of course, I think the most important question, most interesting, is the following. There is this more or less one-to-one correspondence between the branch spaces and the canonical systems. The question is if it's possible to establish this correspondence between Cauchy Branges spaces and some sort of systems. I don't know what kind of system do the Cauchy Branges space correspond to some analysis of canonical systems. We don't know. Other interesting questions are descriptions of study the property of division invariance of spaces, and now let me discuss some applications of this result, and we will consider rank one perturbation of probably simplest possible operator, a compact normal operators in Hilbert spaces. It turns out that this Cauchy Branges spaces is a good model for this rank one perturbation. So let me describe briefly. We consider identify H with L2 with respect to some measure nu, where nu is just a series of point Dirac masses. So we may identify the elements of L2 of mu with sequences An, and we consider rank one perturbation L of the operator. So we add to our operator A rank one perturbation, which can be written, of course, in this way. And we have the following model for rank one perturbations, which was established recently by Anton Baranov and Dmitry Yugovich. So let A be an operator as above, and lambda L is rank one perturbation of A, which is defined using some vectors A and B. And B, let B be a cyclic vector for the operator A, which means simply that Bn is non-zero for any n. And put Tn is the inverse of Sn. Then there exists a positive measure mu, the sum of infinite sum of Dirac measures at the point Tn, which this convergence restriction, Cauchy Branges space HTm A mu, and an entire function G in the space, almost in the space, it belongs to the space plus Z times the same space, which is 1, 0, such that the operator L is unitarily equivalent to the model operator on this space. This is operator which resembles backward shift operator on this space. Roughly speaking, any rank one perturbation of compact normal operator A is unitarily equivalent to a sort of backward shift operator acting on some Cauchy branch space. And the converse is also true. So we can reduce the study of properties of this rank one perturbation of compact normal operators to the properties of functions from Cauchy Branges spaces. In particular, we have the following result. Let me recall that an operator L acting on Hilbert space is said to admit spectral synthesis if it is for any L invariance of space M, M is generated by its eigenvectors or more generally root vectors, which will be denoted by E of me. Okay, so E of me is the linear span of its root vectors, and L is said to admit spectral synthesis if and only if for any invariance of space M, E of me is equal to M. And E of M is a spectral part of M. So we have the following corollary of our result for perturbations. let A be a compact normal operator with simple point spectrum and trivial kernel, and suppose that L is a rank one perturbations such that the operator L and its adjoint have complete sets of eigenvectors. So we define Tn as the inverse of Sn as before, and assume that either A is self-adjoint, so T belongs to R, R is corresponding to the branch spaces, or T satisfies one of the conditions discussed before, previously Z, P, or A gamma. Then the set of all L invariants are spaces with fixed common spectral part is totally ordered by inclusion. So for the case when T is a subset of R, this is a corollary of the branch order Ethereum. And for T satisfies these three conditions, this is corollary of our theorem and this Baranov and Yakubovich constructions of functional model. Okay, so we discussed division invariant subspaces for Cauchy de Branges spaces. And now I will go to the second topic of my talk. This is localization phenomena for zeros in Cauchy de Branges spaces. Okay, so we'll consider the same spaces H, T, mu, and T will be a power separated sequence. So the points of T are not very close to each other. Tn plus one and Tn, the difference will be bounded by some powers of Tn. And assume that the polynomial are dense in L2 of mu. The density of polynomials is a classical subject in analysis, which was studied by many mathematicians starting from the first part of the 20th century. And it turns out that in our Cauchy de Branges spaces, so CDB means Cauchy de Branges space, the density of polynomials in the space L2 of mu can be reformulated in the following way. So there exist disjoint disks centered in Tn of some radii Rn, such that for any non-zero function of our space, each disk contains exactly one zero of the function f. It's true for any n except possibly a finite number. So this property we will call a strong localization property. It means that for any disjoint disk centered of Tn, the zeros are exactly after a finite number in these disks. In any disk, there is one zero. In other words, we will say that the zeros are localized near the set T. So we will study this phenomena, localization of zeros near the set T for the Cauchy de Branges space HT. Actually, we will study some more general property. We say that Cauchy de Branges space HT mu has a localization property if there exists a sequence of disjoint disk, like in the previous slide, such that for any non-zero function f, all zeros of the function f, of the set ZF, are in the union of this disk, except probably a finite number, and each disk contains at most one point of ZF. Each disk contains either one point or zero points. You see that in the previous situation, each disk contains exactly one point, except a finite number, but here it's a larger class, larger more general property. Each disk contains either 0 points of Z of F or 1 point. This property we will call localization property. Okay, so localization property is that, roughly speaking, means that zeros of the function F are all near some points of T. And the strong localization property discussed in the previous slide is that there is more or less up to a finite number, one-to-one correspondence. Not only any zero of F is near some points of T, but also near any point of T, there is a zero. It turns out that if the space has the localization property, then the polynomial belongs to L2 of mu. Okay. Not necessarily dense. They are dense if we have strong localization property, but generally they are not dense, but they belong to L2 of mu. And the first result here in this direction is that we have the following dichotomy. Either we have the localization property, as discussed before, for any, or for any unbounded set gamma, there exists a non-trivial function f in our Cauchy de Branges space, which has infinitely many zeros on gamma. So either we have a localization property, or if not, the zeros of functions from the space can be somehow everywhere. You can choose any, say, discrete sequence gamma subset of C, and you can find a function which has infinitely many zeros on this set. So this is an interesting phenomena, and previously we studied this phenomena for De Branges spaces, and it turns out that there are interesting corollary for direct inverse spectral problem. So you know that it's usually very difficult to establish a relation between some classes of the Branges subspaces and canonical systems, Hamiltonian, which correspond to canonical systems. But here it turns out that there is very easy to formulate correspondence, which is easy to formulate. The Branges spaces which have a localization property corresponds to a Hamiltonian, which consists of individual intervals which accumulate only on the left. So I will not go to details, but there is a natural reformulation in terms of Hamiltonian for the Branges spaces. But for Cauchy, the Branges spaces, there is no at least it is not known. It is not known this correspondence between spaces and canonical systems. So we can study, in any case, this property itself. And the following object, which appears naturally here, is the notion of attraction set. So what is attraction set? If you remember the definition of localization property, it means that the zeros of any function are close to the points of T, but probably not to all points of T. And attraction sets are exactly the subset of T which are close to zeros of some functions of the space. The formal definition is the following. So for any function F, we may associate a set TF, a subset of T, such that the zeros of F are close to Tn. So they are in this disk, except maybe a finite number. And there exists exactly one point of ZF, exactly one zero of F in each disk. Maybe as usual here, a finite number of indices. It turns out that this set TF is determined uniquely up to finite sets. and it is called attraction set. So a subset S of T is an attraction set if there exists a function f in our Cauchy de Branges space H T mu such that Tf is equal to S up to a finite set. And so we have given T and given mu, we have a family of subsets which are attraction sets. It turns out that these subsets, which are attraction sets, are also ordered by inclusion. So this is a theorem. Let HT mu be a Cauchy de Branges space with a localization property. Then for any two attraction sets, S1, S2, either S1 is a subset of S2 or S2 is a subset of S1. Okay, so it's an interesting question. We don't know the answer. Does localization apply the ordering theorem for nearly invariant spaces? So we have for the Cauchy de Branges spaces with localization property, we have the ordered structure of attraction sets, but also we have invariant order structure for division invariant spaces. And it's interesting to establish a relation between these two order structure. And here we don't know the answer. Okay, and I think it will be at the end of my talk. I will discuss some examples of attraction sets. So strong localization means exactly that there is only one attraction set. This is a set T itself. The next case is when we have two attraction sets. T is always an attraction sets, but we can have another set, say T1 or T2. And the last theorem, we will characterize Cauchy de Branges spaces, which has a localization property of type two. It means they have exactly two attraction sets. But before formulate the theorem, I will recall that an entire function f of finite order is in generalized Hamburg-Klein class if it has simple zeros with these asymptotics on the derivative of f at the point zn. And we have the following sort of interpolation formula: one over f of z is the sum of one of divided by phi prime of zn times z minus zn. And we have the following description of Cauchy de Branges spaces with localization property of type two, with exactly two attraction sets. So it happens if and only if there exists the following partition, non-trivial partition, T on T1 and T2, and the following condition holds. There exists an entire function A2 in the generalized Hamburg-Klein class such that the zeros of A2 are exactly at the space T2, the set T2. The second condition, the polynomials, they are in the space L2 on the set T2 with the restriction of mu on this set. They are in the space, but not dense there. So the closure of polynomials is of finite condemnation in this. And also the closure of polynomial is of finite condemnation. And finally, the polynomials belong to the space L2 T1 with some measure mu tilde, which is defined in the following way. Okay, so if these three conditions are satisfied, then T1 and T are the attraction sets for H T mu, and vice versa. If T1 and T are the attraction sets for the space H T mu, then there exists so T2 is divided, is defined just as the complement of T1 and T, and then there exists an entire function A2 and so on, and such that these three conditions are satisfied. It's not easy to construct Cauchy de Branges space which has localization property of type 2. And just some ideas here. That we can start with, we can fix some set T2 and the measure mu 2. And then we can choose some measure mu 1, which decays very much faster than the measure on the set 2, T2. And so here we have a concrete example. Probably I will not go to details, which permits to construct an example of Cauchy de Branges spaces of type 2. And we have a similar description of Cauchy de Branges spaces with localization property of type n. We have, when we have exactly n attraction sets, which are of course ordered by inclusion by our theory. Okay, so I think I will finish by presenting two papers containing results I discussed here. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Eugene, for a wonderful talk. Let's thank you, Eugene. And there is a request in the chat to share your slides. So Eugene, if you can upload the slides in the chat, that would be great.